Two teachings, personal holiness, social righteousness, one gospel. He was not new. You go back to the saints of the church and before the year 1000, it's there. The tension between those who pray and those who do. And a sense is that people who pray withdraw from the world, and those who do become involved in the world. And to some extent that's right, and therefore one of the weaknesses of the emphasis of the quietists, as they're called, was that they withdrew from all the social debate and the social actions, and their impact on the structure of society declined. On the other hand, there's much evidence that people throw themselves into social action, sometimes stop saying their prayers, and sometimes Christian initiatives become non-Christian initiatives. A large number of charities in this country started out as Christian foundations, even football clubs, but they drifted. Well now, and you'll be weary of me saying this, those of you who know in Maranatha, but I have to say it. The letter I received on behalf of Maranatha from Mother Teresa will always remain with me, because she was very strong in her support of what we're doing. It gave a warning, and her warning was this, and I got it ingrained on my heart. She said, if you pray without serving, your prayer will be in vain. If you serve without praying, your service will be in vain. Go forth and pray and serve in the power of the Spirit. Wesley, personal holiness, social righteousness. One gospel, not two. Now, this is what today is about. And I want to start by looking at the inheritance of our nation. There is no nation on earth which has sent forth to the world more missionaries. There are townships in these islands where over half the population went as missionaries, Northern Ireland. There are places in England who have sent missionaries which have transformed nations. And it's important that we realize that the foundations of this nation are Christian. It doesn't mean to say we're a Christian nation, you know, where the overwhelming majority know Jesus and love him, serve him. But it does mean that the foundations of our educational system, for example, are Christian. Foundations of our universities are Christian. The foundations of much of our hospital structure are Christian. And the foundation of our legal system is undoubtedly Christian. Whenever I see the judges processing to Westminster Abbey, you know, in all their robes, I wonder, does this really register in the life of the nation? And the reason why it's at the very foundation of our legislative system is that Jesus spoke of the value of individual people and of their rights. And therefore our conception of democracy in England is very deeply rooted in Christian initiatives. And certainly our conception of freedom. So freedom and democracy, again, are part of our inheritance. And then the inheritance is deeper than that. It is an inheritance in which there was originally a saturation in prayer of almost everything we did, hence school assemblies, hence as recently as 40, 50 years ago, the major teaching hospitals in London, the nurses had prayers before they went into the wards. So that is the nature of our society. Therefore, the fabric of Britain has benefited enormously. If you look at the charitable institutions in Britain, far and away the majority are Christian foundations today. If they were to shut down, there'd be a societal collapse. The politicians are beginning to recognize this. And there's a major debate this week, led by a dear friend of ours, because the Charity Commission is now getting its teeth into churches and saying you've got to prove that you do good in society. You know, first time. In our culture, we've got to do this.
So they decided they'd choose a small Plymouth Brethren church at Preston Book. And they put them through the mill. And they've had to go to council and pay thousands of pounds to defend their position as Christians, to prove what they did. And what they did, this little church, was to feed the hungry, visit the sick, teach the young. But the new atheistic influence in our culture is forcing churches to do that. And they said, you don't allow people in your church to take communion unless they meet your criteria. That was bad. Well, wait until they look at the Catholic Church. I never thought I'd hear Ian Paisley's son in the House of Lords speak out for the Catholic Church, but he did this week on this issue. Because the attack upon our Christian culture is now blisteringly hot. There is a secular humanist lobby, quite small, but very well organized, is what today is going to be about. They are highly organized. They know exactly what they're doing. And they are determined to drive the church into the periphery. And even the barrister speaking in the European court on our behalf said in hearings a few weeks ago, you must leave your religion at your door when you go out to work. And no one in public life challenged that. So that's where we are. Bishop Leslie Newbegin, a man who was a member of our community, had huge influence on the church globally. URC saint. We don't have saints in the URC, but I think you know what I mean. He said the gospel is public truth, or it's nothing. It's public truth. Therefore, we have got to go out into the public arena and speak publicly on anything. This week, Hans Christian and I have been speaking at a public inquiry into the possibility of building a power station, an incinerated power station, a couple of miles down the road here. I don't draw any distinction between doing that and proclaiming Jesus, because his command to us is very clear, but we'll come on to that later. We are now living in an increasingly alien environment. Member of Maranatha's won his court case yesterday. I forget his name. Oh, what's he called? Adrian. He's won. Because he happened to say he was against single-sex marriage, he nearly lost his job. He was demoted. He was made into a rent collector when he was a senior manager in the local housing association here in this borough. And we managed to get the churches to go and lobby. But I have to tell you, this is happening all over the country. The battle is on. We are in warfare now. And if you think otherwise, I would plead with you to read some of the literature we've produced in the last 5 years. The evidence of the de-Christianizing process is there, all the way through. I won't weary you with the details. So that's the scenario, okay? I would affirm Maranatha's statement that now a battle is raging for the soul of our nation. And if people in public life still do not see it in certain quarters, the whole world sees it. We're having people from Africa, from Indonesia, from India, all over the world saying, do you realize what is happening to your nation? Do you realize a struggle is taking place for its very soul? You who sent missionaries all over the world, we now come here and we weep. So, the past, the present. Now let's pause and look at two biblical models. Linda will lead us.
Good to set today in the context of obviously biblical example. And in praying about today, two people came to mind, quite famous biblical people. And I thought it'd be good to look at some of the attributes of both David from the Old Testament and Jesus, obviously, Gospel, in terms of getting an understanding of how the Lord maybe wants us to work. So, first of all, David. So, I'm not going to read all these biblical verses. If you want this, I can give you a copy afterwards. If you want to write it down, write it down. But it was said of David, and wasn't said of any other king, that he was a man after the Lord's own heart. That was the first and foremost important quality that he had. He was also known as a man who was seeking the honour and glory of God. You've only got to see at the outset when he first came on the scene from the fields, and his big brother said, "What are you doing here?" And he said, "Who's this Philistine that's trying to mock our God? And I'll show him," basically. So his whole heart was to honour and to glorify God, and that was reflected in his own personal life. He was a worshipper of the Lord. And you remember that his own daughter mocked her. Was it his daughter?
Wife.
Thank you. Actually, ridiculed him because of the extravagance of his worship. He was a leader who had total confidence in the Lord and also in the Lord's way of doing things. He had absolute trust in the Lord. He declared, you know, this battle belongs to God. God will be victorious. He didn't boast of his own strength. But what he did know was he knew what weapons he could use. I mean, I suppose the prime example was when he had his 5 stones and his sling when he was a young man. Following that, he went out and he was a great warrior. But David knew the weapons that he could use, and he knew how to use the weapons that had been given. David was a man who most importantly consulted the Lord about everything. If you look at the pattern of David's life, when he was going out to battle, he always consulted the Lord. And the particular point about that I felt we needed to note was that, do you remember there was a time when David was fighting the Philistines? He inquired of the Lord, and the Lord said, "Yes, go out and you'll defeat them." He defeated them. And then the Philistines came back again, and David said, "Oh, we're going to do this again." And the Lord said, "Do it a different way this time." So he was a man who was attentive to the Lord so that he heard. He didn't just rely on doing things the same way as he'd done them before. He actually was a man who was so listening to what the Lord wanted that he heard when the Lord said, "No, we'll do it a different way this time." So those are just a few examples. I could say a lot more about David. His humility, his willingness to repent when the Lord brought disaster because David had taken a census. David said, please don't harm the people. He said, "They're only sheep. I'm the one that's to blame. Take it out on me." You know, this was a great king and leader. So we're getting these are all pointers to what was in David's heart. If we look at Jesus, you could say so much, but I've just selected key points that I feel are important for us to note in looking at our own attitude in our witness. The first thing was, he was totally one with the Father. And you'd say, "Well, that's okay, because he was God, so he had to be one with the Father." No, that's not the point. He sought oneness with his Father at all times. And he made clear that his whole purpose was to bring God's kingdom here on earth. He was seeking for the kingdom of God to be revealed. And also God's ways, God's will. He made clear that he's not of the world, but more importantly, he said that we're not of the world. Mm-hmm. If we are in Christ, then we are not of the world. What does it mean to be of the world? Who do you belong to? Who are you answerable to? And yes, we have good teaching on honouring those who are in authority, but first and foremost, we're answerable to the Lord. The Bible makes it clear that, you know, if we go about seeking to please men, then we can't please God. Jesus said, "Don't seek to please the world." Jesus, fundamentally, I mean, here's Almighty God coming in human form. If you notice that I've put at the beginning of each of these, he's a man. Jesus, the man. He operated as a man. A lot of people think, oh, well, you know, he's God, so he didn't actually have the fullness of our humanity. Wrong. Jesus is fully man. He's come to show us what's possible in our humanity. That's awesome. And remember, he said, "You're going to do greater things than I did." Again, very troubling. Humility was the mark of Jesus. He, being Almighty God, you know the passage from Philippians, he didn't seek anything for himself. Again, he was seeking the kingdom of God. And his obedience, it said in Hebrews that he learned obedience through what he suffered. He didn't please himself. Fundamentally, he didn't please himself when it came to the cross. Jesus was marked for his prayer life. It says readily in the Gospels, he went off on his own to pray. Now, you know, look at that. If Jesus needed to take time out to pray, who are we? And he didn't trust in his own power or his own way of doing things. When you read John's Gospel particularly, Jesus keeps on saying, I'm not doing this on my own. I don't do anything without the Father telling me. Finally, one of Dennis's favourite scriptures. Jesus warned us that we should be as shrewd as snakes and as innocent as doves. And maybe this opportunity to just reflect on that today. What does that actually mean in the context of what we're about today? Shall I just carry on to obedience, Dennis? Is that
yes.
So the next part of our morning is just reflecting on the fact that our main call is obedience here. I had a little exchange with a Christian leader recently. Now, I'm not anybody. I don't have any theological training or anything like that. So this man did. He's got all sorts of doctorates and things. But he had been talking about the key thing that Christians need to do today is to understand the signs of the times and to understand what God is doing. And I suggested to him, I said, well, for me, not having all that biblical knowledge and understanding, for me, the most important thing is to hear God and to obey him. And I would suggest that obedience trumps understanding. Now, he disagreed. I'll leave it open to you to debate. But in order to be obedient, we need to listen. We need to watch all of our senses. You know, that's how we receive information, is through our senses. So, are we alert? Are our senses filled with God's Spirit in such a way that we are tuned in to what he's saying? If you see something, is it automatically revealing something that God wants to show you? Obviously, we need to be people of prayer, and there needs to be a response. Just a few words about obedience. Obedience starts with a listening and humble heart. Mm-hmm. The opposite to that is starting from the point of view that says, I know what to do. I love you, King Jehoshaphat. When he was surrounded by the armies, here he was, a great king, and what did he say? He got on his knees and he said, Lord, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. That comes from a humble and a listening heart. Obedience, godly obedience, has to be motivated by love. That there is no other way. This is how Jesus teaches us. If we go out campaigning in a judgmental attitude, the world will fire back judgment at us, rightly so. If we operate from a place of judgment, we will be judged. But if we are genuinely seeking to be obedient to what God calls us to, because we love him and we love his ways, then I believe that God will honour what we do. Obedience listens. There's a move that's very important here. Listening and hearing are not the same thing. You know, I've just listened to Dennis say maybe something about Charles Wesley and social righteousness and personal holiness. So I listened to that, but did I hear what he was saying? In other words, did I hear that this is something we need to look at in our lives? So listening and hearing need to follow on. Hearing needs to follow our listening. We need to reflect it back to God. And if we hear God say something, actually we need to reflect it back and say, okay, Lord, so I've heard you say this, but what does that mean? Am I really hearing? And if you remember the prophecy of Isaiah, that was the curse that came on the people. There'll be ever hearing but not understanding. That's the same principle. And then, when we've actually heard, there's a need for us to respond. And I'd like to say something about timing. This is where I have a big problem. Timing. I hear God. God says, I want you to do this. And I consistently make the mistake of doing one of two things. Either I make the mistake of rushing in and trying to do it now, and then it doesn't work. Or I make the mistake of saying, oh yes, God wants me to do this, but I'll just do these other things first. And the one thing I think I've learned probably more from Dennis than anybody is to have that heart that is actually sensitive to the Lord's time. Mm. I'll give you an example. Anne-Marie there wrote all the material for the new book that we've just published, What on Earth We Do, the big question, What on Earth We Doing to Our Children. And she heard the Lord say, that needs to be finished by the end of this last year. And we were keen to get it on the move, we were keen to get it published. We've just published it now, a year later. What's that about? Is it because we were just lazy and dilatory? And well, we asked those questions, but we had a sense that the Lord was saying, it's okay, this is my time. Now that we've just published it, everybody's saying, wow, this is God's time. So we were ready. We thought we were working to one time scale, but actually the Lord delayed it. We don't know why, except maybe we assume it's the right time now. Take another example. When we were in Ireland one day, we were driving along, we were late for a meeting, and as we were driving down the road, Jim was in the driving seat, Dennis was in the passenger seat, and Dennis said, turn into that church now. I was in the back seat saying, we have a lot of time to turn into the church now. Jim, fortunately, was a much more obedient man, and swung around, went into the car park, and Dennis said, there's somebody in there we've got to see. I'm saying, but they're waiting at the meeting. They went in, and sure enough, there was a lady who we'd met once before at a Maranatha meeting, and she was in great distress, and she'd been asking the Lord to help her. We only stopped a few minutes, but we prayed. Being attentive, listening to the Lord. Finally, what I said at the beginning, our obedience must not be dependent on our understanding. That doesn't mean to say that the Lord doesn't give us understanding, he does. But our obedience mustn't depend on us understanding what God has asked us to do. Does that make sense? Yeah. Okay. So, the simple call of Jesus.
On timing, I think you should know that our meeting is in 3 weeks' time. I was astonished. The meeting in Parliament, when we've got a massive array of leading Christians in Parliament to support our publication, The Big Question, What on Earth Are We Doing to Our Children? I didn't realize that the first person I asked was a good friend of Maranatha's, the Bishop of Chester. What happened 10 days ago, fortnight ago, he launched a major debate on children in the House of Lords, which has had a foundational influence upon thinking. And then again, our good friend, the member for the North Cheshire constituency, Fiona, you know, the timing is that she sponsored a meeting on the sexualizing of children a fortnight ago, was it? Something like that. See how God's pieces all together. And it's quite extraordinary that suddenly parliamentarians are telling me, well, it was very clever of Maranatha to choose that date in December, which is the date before the most devastating statement for the last 5 years on our economy. And I said, well, hang on, what's the children got to do with the economy? And of course, an awful lot. Intergenerational thieving, they call it now in Westminster. Children born bankrupt. Not bankrupt financially alone, but spiritually and morally. So, and that's literally the day after our meeting. And we could go on giving evidence of the way in which God is having his working his purpose out. And I think, forgive me if you've heard this before, but I think in order to get this straight, I've got to quote the thing which will be in my mind forever. We had to produce a very carefully worded document for Professor Torrance at at Edinburgh, was a great biblical scholar, and I won't go into details, it was about human sexuality. And it had to be right, absolutely right. And we worked against a deadline, and in the morning, due out at one, wasn't it? And Sheila and I said, in human terms, we failed. We can't do it. Impossible. So Sheila said, well, let's pray specifically for God to take action. So we prayed and said, Lord, we are weak, but you are mighty. We are afraid, we are worried, we are concerned, and there's tension. I went to the office, went upstairs to the office, which Charles now has, and I sat down. 5 minutes later, a knock on the door, and it was a lady who'd come from Taunton, I think, somewhere, Somerset, where. And she said, oh, I've got just 4 hours. I'll do anything. I'll clean the loos. I'll put stamps on paper. And I said, well, tell me about yourself. What do you do? And she said, I'm a teacher. I said, well, what do you teach? English language, English literature. We needed someone to go right through the manuscript to be absolutely right. Spelling, grammar, presentation. God brought her. I said, go into the front room, bless you. Less than 5 minutes later, there was a knock on the door, and we don't get barristers knocking every door, unfortunately, I should say, on the door of the office, but someone with Hans Christian, I know it is Ed Morgan, he's now a judge. Anyway, Ed said, I'm going to the courts at 1 o'clock, 1 o'clock notice. I've got between now and then, I'll do anything for you, Dennis. Doesn't matter what, stuffing envelopes, I'll do it. Now, we needed the advocacy of that article, that series of articles, very carefully put together. So God brought the two things we needed at precisely the time when they were needed. And we've got a very clever man in Maranatha who works on probability theories called Anton, and he's an amazing man. But I said, you know, what's the possibility of coincidence here? And I won't go into it, it's so many millions and millions and millions to one. But it happened. Okay, why do I tell you this? Basically, because the simplicity of the subject we're dealing with today, and we'll be getting onto a lot of practical stuff shortly, the simplicity is to recognize that God speaks in simple language. So God, I've got to say it again, some of you have heard it. If you go to the beginning of the book of Jeremiah and Isaiah, and so many of the prophetic works, you will find one word emphatically appearing, and that word is go. Go. I really think the best translation is get the hell out of here, but anyway, that's another matter. But the point is, these men of God were told to go. Nehemiah hadn't even been to Jerusalem. Go. You could go right the way through. Now, this process of hearing God and responding without understanding is fundamental. And in case you think it's an oversimplification, I've been to one or two theological colleges, and I'm not even an amateur theologian, but I've had to say, look, why have you made the message of Jesus so complicated in your teaching? Jesus said, come. Jesus said, go. Jesus said, follow. Jesus said, ask. Jesus said, knock. Jesus said, seek. Everyone knows what these words stand for. The message is simple, simple, simple. Why have you made it complicated? And therefore, the whole essence of today is simply to say to God, what do you want of me? Here am I. In my house, which is just across the way there, years ago, I had Eric at 3 o'clock in the morning knocking on the door saying, God's told me to go to Uganda. Well, no, Sudan it was, isn't it? That's right. And I said, well, that's fine, yes. At 3 o'clock in the morning, the mind isn't exactly. So we had a cup of coffee, but and we said, we'll talk about it. He came back the next night at 3 o'clock in the morning. Sheila was none too pleased. And anyway, we got talking, and of course, what happened? He heard God say, go! Against everyone's advice, he went. Got this long wheelbase ambulance, took him with him, a doctor and a nurse, and he set up that remarkable centre in Uganda, in Sudan, East Africa, for children with mental problems, to say the least. Anyway, it happened. He heard God say, go, and he went. And that is the history of Maranatha. That's exactly what the founder of Mother's Prayers did. She was told to go. Which was the first country she went to?
Russia was quite early on.
Yeah. But God said, go, the most unlikely place, and get mums to pray for kids. And now there are thousands and tens of thousands of Mother's Prayer groups all over the world because she was obedient. She said, God said, go, and she went. And again, with the guy who runs Barnabas in Manchester, Peter, he God said, get into the city. And he went into the city on a wet Saturday night, and he was miserable as sin, and he rang me and said, I'm standing on Portland Street corner, and God's told me to come to this blinking city. Where does he want me to go? I said, well, you've answered your question. Now, this moment, say to God, where do you want me to walk from where I am? And that was the end of that a rather difficult telephone conversation. And then, later, in great elation, he said, he told me to cross the road, take the second on the right, the second on the left. And so I did. And there were two youngsters, absolutely blotto, with whiskey bottles around them. And God led them to him. Into them. And that's how Barnabas' ministry started. Now, it's very, very important that we grab this in our complicated culture where we've seen this revolution in the last 15 years in terms of information, techniques, IT. But the simple matter is that God wants to gather his people in order that they may collectively listen. Nowhere in the Bible does he say set up a committee. God help us. Committees, committees, committees on everything. All around, and they come after spending hours in committee, think they've worked. I mean, it just is, the concept of the people of God gathering to listen to God, to praise him, is as crucial now as it ever was. Yet we do not give that space to listen. Now, it's more than that. It's watching. Are we prepared to see what is going on in the world? Now, we were led a number of years ago, I don't know how many years, you know, you must tell me, to look at the evil of child abuse. And God directed our gaze, but more than that, he brought to us abused people. From Scotland, Wales, all over the country. So in other words, all that he wanted us to do was to open our eyes to see what he was showing us. Okay? And out of that came a recognition that there was sickness in society. So you see in my notes, the gospel is about healing. Healing of the body, the mind, the spirit. But in looking at what's going on, we've got to actually recognize with great precision the sickness in our land and in our churches. Because if we don't, there's no need for a saviour. There isn't any need for a healer. And there is sickness in church and nation. Again, the gospel is about unity. And facing up to the division in our land and in the churches. I mean, do we realise how desperately serious it is? I'll give you an instance. I met one of the leading atheists in Parliament who invited me to address a meeting of MPs. What was his message? There's not one issue you Christians have got hot and bothered about, from abortion right up to single-sex marriage, that could not have been defeated like that if you lot had spoken with one voice. That's an atheist telling me, a Christian, a biblical truth. We have been divided, terribly, demonically divided. And we haven't spoken with one voice. Even now in Scotland, you know, we've got the problem of some church leaders emphatically going in favor of abortion, in favor of single-sex marriage, in favor of all sorts of things. And others going, and the people there say, well, who do we believe? You Christians are just looking in both directions. Now, do we believe that that can be resolved ecumenically? Answer, no. Because that will lead to the kind of human, worldly compromise. And I'm not interested in that kind of compromise. Do we believe that if those same Christians came together to pray, that God can't make them of one heart and mind? O Jerusalem, how I would gather you together as a hen gathers her chicks, but you would not. And I once met an archbishop in this country the day before a synod and had 2 hours with him. And he had this document with all the motions and amendments and all the rest of it. And I said, well, to what extent, Archbishop, do you listen to God? He said, I wish we could just scrap this program and all of us get onto our knees and listen. That's an archbishop, Anglican archbishop. And it seems to me that this is so basic that if we keep on being disobedient to God, we must expect the consequences. And the truths of the Old Testament, the warnings which we put in several leaflets about the nation that turns its back upon God and the church which doesn't listen, are there written large. And it's frightening. So this is, therefore, when I use the word fear, I'm talking about urgency. And then again, if we look at the concept about life, last Pope, Pope John Paul, said that we have created a culture of death. And that wasn't just about killing millions of children in the mother's womb. It was much more than that. But there is deadness in our land. I mean, I'm not pointing a finger at young people who wear black clothes and sing goth songs. But if you read the words of the goth songs and you see the fruit of that lifestyle, it is death, no question. And we have created culturally an attitude which favors death more than life. In his first Maranatha lecture at Manchester University this year, David Alton told a shocked audience of what is happening in Holland now on euthanasia. You ring up your friendly disposal unit and they kindly send a van with two doctors and a nurse and they put the patient to death and take the body away. It's all simple, clean, neat. Very reminiscent of Hitler. Strangely, it should happen in Holland. But that is happening. The devaluation of life. And people who are not asking to be killed, by the way. 50% of all the euthanasia acts are taken in Holland without the permission of the patient. Think of that, the significance. Now, does this make you angry? It made the audience there very angry. So the gospel is about life, renewal, revival. And if we don't see the deadness around us, we are blind. If we do not see the deadness in some of our council estates, if we do not see the deadness of smashed families, of children who are born drug addicts, who are born alcoholics, we've got all the figures if you want them, of children having children, of children having abortions. This is a culture of death, which we have happily encouraged. Sorry to use that word, it's judgmental, forgive me. But we have got a lot to seek God's forgiveness for. Our silence on these issues has been deafening. That is why God gave these three words right at the beginning, 30 years ago, to Maranatha, of unity, healing, and renewal. Life. Unity, healing, renewal. Now, how do we go about this? Are we prepared to recognize that the church made mistakes? I addressed a Catholic conference a little while ago, and I was so inspired because a lot of these comparatively young Catholics were recognizing that the concept of having a state ruled by the church politically was a failure. we married the world and we took the consequences. And I feel that we've got to recognize, therefore, that instead of being at the top of the pile, we've got to go back to the bottom of the pile. So the honor we give in church structures must be to bless the poor. So our calling, as Carlo Coretta said to me personally, he is that remarkable Italian Christian who led the Little Brothers of the Dead, Charles de Foucault. And he said, you and Maranatha are being raised up to be little brothers and sisters of Jesus. And I grabbed that and we've held on to it ever since. Now, you can be proud about being humble, so be careful. But the fact of the matter is, if you start recognizing that you are a little brother and sister of Jesus, then God can do great things. The moment we absorb the power structures of the world, we are diminished. And it's been a privilege God has given to us. We've met a lot of very, very influential, powerful people, wealthy people, in politics and in public life. And it's now becoming apparent, increasingly apparent to them, not just to us. They're on a hiding to nothing. I spoke to a very senior politician. He said, I've wasted my life. He hadn't. He'd done good things. But he suddenly, faced with Jesus, realized that his motives, his incentives were all wrong. He wanted power. He wanted prestige. He wanted the things that our culture is telling its children are good. The celebrity culture. And we know where that's got us in recent days with one particular person. So, we're called to be little brothers. We're called to be salt and light. Now, here I want to get nearer the bone. You'll be wondering how long it's going to be before we really get into the nitty-gritty. But here it is. If we are going to be salt and light, salt has got to be dispersed to have an influence. We have got to be dispersed in our society. We haven't got to be in little ghettos, where we are increasingly now. And secondly, we've got to be light. Now, I'm talking about the light of a torch now, which is directed, not just the light of a candle. The symbol of light is very important. God will direct that beam of light to the object he wants us to see. When I said this a number of years ago, somebody said at a Maranatha meeting in Newmarket at Caremba, you'll want to switch the light off. And I didn't know what he meant. But I did much later, when Linda and I were drawn into the most appalling cases of child abuse involving murder and mayhem. Then I realized God had got us to get that torch and shine it there. It wasn't our intellectual decision. We weren't searching. God said, look at this. Look at that. And in prayer, we did it. And it just went on and on and on, so that the community which was prepared as a community of listening people, of praying people, was prepared by God for probably 10 years. And then God said, now I've got something to show you. So, in other words, the dynamic Jesus displaced the static Jesus. For many, in our schools, children are taught, well, there was a person called Jesus who lived 2,000 years ago. You know, they're taught what he said. They're taught what he did. Not what he says, not what he does now. A static Jesus. Now, the Jesus we're talking about is the Jesus who has been experienced by so many in Témoin community in France, and obviously with the newer communities which have arisen all over the world, where Jesus is on the move. Jesus is a running savior, and we can't keep up with him. Come here, I've got something to show you. Come to the slums of Calcutta. Come to the Congo and see the atrocities. Come to what's happening in the real world. I want you to shine your torch on it. Do you see what I'm trying to say? So, I then had blistering criticism from some people. Maranatha is giving bad news. Now, the gospel is good news. But you can only understand what is good news if you compare it with the bad news. And it's got to be accurate. It's got to be true. No exaggeration. So the one rule we've had is that if we produce a report in Parliament, which we do, we're coming on to them, or a briefing report for church leaders, it has got to be unassailable. The moment we make a statement which is unreliable, our credibility goes. But Linda's been at many meetings in the House where peers and MPs have said, we are prepared to consider what you're saying. We do trust your documents. So truth matters, and we've got to get the light shining on those areas which are very, very dangerous, and we'll be coming on to them. So let's just go back. Our involvement is therefore in a gospel which changes men and women one by one and which changes society. Christ is involved in transformation. Now, I believe that our culture, our Christian culture, has been in retreat, in reverse. We've been defensive. I don't believe that that is God's will. Otherwise, you'll be labelled conservative, small c. You'll be labelled reactionary, traditional. All the words that the press are used to throw against Christians who object to anything. So therefore, it's the dynamic of the gospel. It's the passion of people who say, but we cannot allow our children to be dealt with like this, that motivates that transformation in society. The moment we travel the other route of saying, pointing our finger at Jim will fix it or whoever it might be, we're in trouble, deep trouble. There but for the grace of God go I. Let him who is without sin cast the first stone. So do you understand? Our motivation is rooted in compassion and must be seen to be rooted in compassion. Otherwise, we'll make a great long list of everything that's wrong and we will be associated with it. So I want to say the crisis and glory have been given to us, these two words, and given to others, by the way, we're discovering. We are in high crisis, and if you don't admit this, we're not on the same wavelength. We can't walk very closely together because it's staring us in the face. I mean, the crisis which was revealed by God in banking is staggering. The crisis revealed yesterday by the House of Commons Select Committee on Public Expenditure is staggering. They've said publicly, we may never, ever get the £64 billion back we paid for Royal Bank of Scotland and the other bank. The government, the people were informed, it's all right, you know, it's public money, we'll get it back. They've actually gone on record as saying, we may never get it back. When Mr. Osborne speaks the day after our Maranatha meeting, we know we're going to hear some devastating words. Now, we've got to recognize that it's not a financial crisis, it's a spiritual crisis. Because after the banks crashed, then we had the MPs' expenses. And after the MPs' expenses, we had the misdemeanors and the press. And after the misdemeanors and the press, we had the bribery and the police. And after bribery and the police, we've got all these examples of child abuse. It's not The Guardian or The Times that's doing this, it's God. God is a God of revelation. He reveals these things, and he's revealing the full spectrum to this nation. And if we just turn over to the sports page, we're opting out of responsibility. And our deafening silence as Christians has got to be broken very soon. Therefore, the concept of crisis and glory is a very, very fundamental one. And the glory part is a process of being aware of the grandeur of the might and power and awesome nature of God. Now, this is the problem in the church. We discussed it yesterday at our meeting in Westminster. There are two words, immanence and transcendence. We need to have them engraved in our hearts at the moment. Immanence is speaking of the God who is close to us. The God who calls you and me by name. The Jesus who is fully human. That's the immanence. The God we can encounter, we can meet and experience. But then the second word is immanence. The God who is awesome, transcendence, who is awesome, who has the whole cosmos in his hands, you know, before whom we should tremble. Now, if we have the one experience and not the other, we will get distorted vision. And there are many Christians who are prepared to stick at the one. And there are many Christians who are prepared to stick at the other because they don't want God to be breathing down their neck. And this is not a theological, theoretical debate. It's an immediate debate for the church. And it's an immediate issue for every Christian in our nation. Now, that's the scene which we're setting for today. And it's a very, very clear and simple one. And I'm going to ask now, just for a moment, for any response before we jump really deep in. We're ahead of time, which is good, if we can jump into the issues. But is there anything that I've said which causes any questioning? Because I'm very disappointed if everyone agrees with everything I say. That would be. But you understand, I'm thinking aloud. I'm sharing not only my views, but the views expressed right across this community. So I'm going to pause now, and I don't mind awkward silences. No silence is awkward. But I'm going to ask you if there's anything immediately that comes to mind before we then move on to face some of the issues.
Yes, I've got a question. Please. I'd like to ask you how you think we can put all this over to our present Christian communities, who are largely pleasantly unaware and asleep, but very well intentioned.
The only answer I have is that we as a community and others who share our vision have got to be still more immersed in the churches. Now, for that reason, we've produced an enormous range of prayer material, which is now being taken up by the churches. The Shalom prayer, the love prayer, the micro prayers, mother's prayers, and so on. So that's beginning to bear fruit. On the other hand, we've got something which we'll be referring to later, which is Trumpet Call, which says, these are the issues, are you prepared to do anything about them? And I have to tell you that at the last election, we did a Trumpet Call, which I deliberately got out here, which we don't know how many hundreds of thousands got it, but we did suggest that churches photostarted it. And many churches did 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 copies. And in that, we said, this is the situation, these are the questions you should be asking. Fortunately, we did hear after the general election. I had to go to hospital to have an operation, so I wasn't able to see the follow-up immediately, but it did have an impact. People were challenged. So in a curious way, I think we've got to be a mild irritant in the church, that eyes are open. There is blindness, because when we produced A Call to the Nation years ago, we included an evidence sheet. And I'm wondering whether someone can get me a copy of any evidence sheet. But what we did was to produce two or three lines, just a fact and a source of the fact, always important. And we placed it in the hands of church leaders, and we placed it in the hands of MPs. Thereafter, in debates in the House of Commons, people were, in fact, quoting our figures. And there is a typical one. I mean, it's small print. And when you've seen it, you may care to pass it on. But we sent here This was the second time we did this, a State of the Nation, in which we said things are serious, and we produced that. But I have to tell you, the first time we did this, it was called
A Call to the Nation.
How many copies went out? 7.5 million. How many were taken up by the churches? 110,000. That was my first learning. The society was interested in this and interested in those facts, which you may get to pass on to other people. But we found enormous interest then in those facts. Almost nil interest in the church. But things have changed. And now, when we produce material, a lot of church people do come to have enormous number of pastors and ministers and priests and bishops. And so it's there is good news. There is an awakening. But that gives you an idea of how we did it. But it's extremely difficult. There is apathy in the church. And there is the need to really rock the boat.